Recorded Books Incorporated presents an unabridged recording of On All Hallows' Eve, written and narrated by Grace Chetwin. This book, copyrighted 1984 by Grace Chetwin, is recorded by permission of the Jean V. Nagar Literary Agency. This performance is copyrighted 1991 by Recorded Books Incorporated. In the wood on All Hallows' Eve, gentle Queen Graylin and her followers have been confined to a clearing amidst the birch trees, while, in a huge cavern, the Dark Queen Samana, the Spike, and the Craven are preparing for a horrid ritual, waiting for a victim from our world. In our world, Meg and her sister Sue have gone to the Halloween party at their new school in Locust Valley on Long Island. There, Sue meets her many friends, and Meg comes up against her enemy, the bully Kenny Stover. Trouble ensues. Soon Meg and Sue are running for their lives, straight into the ruined cottage on Horse Hollow Road, that proves to be a passage to the Halloween wood. And now, On All Hallows' Eve.
But there is no road through the woods. Rudyard Kipling. Chapter 1. The two girls trudged along Horse Hollow Road in their Halloween costumes, the cold from Long Island Sound at their backs. Meg scuffed the dying, drying leaves along the way, flicking them to her left across her sister's path, waiting. Under the yellow streetlight, their breath made little round clouds, teasing clouds that danced ahead of them, then dissolved like will-o'-the-wisps. Meg opened her mouth and blew out hard, watching the little puff of vapour curl away. Yes, she thought, like will-o'-the-wisps, or speech balloons in a comic strip. A comic strip called Red Riding Hood Bugs the Baby Witch. All she needed were words for Sue's balloons, words that should be coming any minute now. She flicked the leaves again, and, at last, her trick paid off. Meg, cut it out! Holding on to her witch's hat, Sue pushed past Meg and crossed the road. Just because you don't want to go to the party, there's no need to take it out on me. Meg laughed in triumph. She saw her sister's words, peppered with asterisks and exclamation points, dancing in front of Sue's baby face. How easy it was to get Sue's goat. Still, Meg was glad of an excuse to cross the road, for there was something about that part of Horse Hollow that gave her the creeps. She looked back over her shoulder and shivered, as though cold fingers had touched the nape of her neck. She always shivered when she saw that broken-down fence and the ruined cottage behind it. She could not say why, but they filled her with a strong sense of foreboding. A cold came from that place, even in warm sunlight, and it had been really warm when they had come to Locust Valley early in September, a month or so before. Of course, she had not wanted to leave England. "You'll like it in the States, you'll see," Father had told her. "But school's only just started." "Believe it or not, they have schools over there too," Father had replied. "And since when did you like the one you're at now? Come on, Meg, face it. Wherever you've gone, you've been unhappy and fighting inside a week." "That's not true. I've just started Latin classes with Mrs. Drew, and she says I'm off to a good start." Father had laughed then, the laugh that said that Meg would not get her way this time. "I won't go, I won't," she had told herself over and over every night in bed. She had even tried to make a pact with Sue to run away, but baby Sue had refused. "Oh, well, I shall just go off to Wales by myself until they've all gone, and then Gran and Grandad Jenkins will have to take care of me. But she hadn't gone off. And here she was, in glorious Locust Valley on Long Island, USA. She thought about the kids she'd left behind in England. Even the ones she'd really disliked were better than the ones here. She hated the way they stared at her, and the way they laughed at how she spoke. The only thing worse was the way the grown-ups gushed. "What a cute accent," they said, every time she opened her mouth. Oh, she could spit! She kicked savagely at a fallen branch and ran up behind Sue. How Sue waddles when she is mad, Meg thought, like Donald Duck. And how crazy her hair looks, flying out like that around the rim of her pointy hat. It flared to bright yellow under the street light, like a halo or an undercooked doughnut. Meg laughed aloud. Sue had father's silky blonde hair, of course, not the wiry black thatch she'd gotten from mother. Like brambles it was, especially under the brush. Sue had father's round, pink English face, too, while she herself had a dark, thin Welsh face, a Celtic face, so mother said. Remember, you're a Celt, and a Jenkins, like me. That is why you are called Mivanwy, after Gran Jenkins, and Gwyneth, for great-aunt Jones. Mivanwy meant my fine one, as mother told her again and again. But even in kindergarten, her name had brought her nothing but trouble. "They won't say it right," she told her mother. "They call me Miffy and laugh when I get mad." Day after day she came home crying, until mother went into school to tell the teacher to call her by a new name, Meg, taking the M from Mivanwy and the G from Gwyneth. Even then it was a long time before the children changed from Miffy to Meg. "Never mind," mother had consoled her. "One day you won't be in school any longer, and then you'll be proud of your names." And mother would tell Meg wonderful stories about old Wales to cheer her up, especially about Morgan le Fay, King Arthur's witch sister. "Do you think her blood is in us, Mother?" Meg would ask. "Perhaps," Mother always said. "Perhaps." Not that anybody in Locust Valley could care about Meg's Celtic blood or Morgan le Fay. At least the kids back in England had asked her to tell them stories sometimes, in the lunch line or out on the playground. And for a while, she would feel all warm and part of things. But these kids thought her strange to be talking about such matters, especially that big bully, Kenny Stover. From the first he had mocked her accent loudly in front of the others. And when he had overheard her trying to tell about how Morgan le Fay had given King Arthur his sword Excalibur, Kenny really had shown his dislike. "Hey, come off it, you guys," he'd said. "Quit listening to that stuff. That Wilson kid's too weird." "Wilson," Meg sighed. Well, at least he'd never heard of Miffy. She had watched him swagger off down the hall, longing to pay him back. But she hadn't. Yet. If she ever heard him coming down the corridor, she would dodge around the corner and not come out until he had gone. Now, to make things worse, he'd found out about her violin. It was all Mother's fault. In spite of Meg's protests, Mother had stormed the principal's office on the first day and got her extra time off from school to practice. As a consequence, she had had to play for the whole school in assembly last week. Since then, there had been no holding Kenny Stover. Now, whenever he saw her, he would swing an imaginary fiddle up onto his shoulder and make the strangest whining noises somewhere up his nose. Of course, Everybody laughed and avoided her now as if she had the plague. Oh, bother Kenny Stover and her violin. But it's not Kenny, really, Sue told her. And it's not the violin either. It's you. You act so stuck up. Sally Carpenter leaves to practice ice skating 4 days a week and no one minds her. Meg sighed again. Even her own sister turned against her when the chips were down. More than ever, she wanted to run away somehow, back to Gran and Grandad Jenkins. Hey, Sue! Mother told us to stick together. Shifting her red riding hood basket onto one arm, Meg snatched at Sue's black witcher shawl, Mother's favourite evening shawl, actually. But Sue shook her off in a rare fit of independence. She also said a lot of other things. Not that they'll make much difference to you. Oh, just listen to her. Difference! Difference! Meg rolled the R's to the point of absurdity. You should just hear yourself. She drew alongside Sue. You don't sound American at all, and you don't sound English anymore either. You don't sound like anything. I do so, Sue cried, forced at last to slow her pace. Too many crisps and toffees, Father had said. Potato chips and candy, they called them here. Meg made a face. Would she ever get it straight? Sue had already. She always managed to land on her little pink feet. Why, she had even wormed her way into the fifth grade instead of the fourth, where she belonged. If Sue could have gotten into Meg's sixth grade class, she would have, Meg was sure. And friends! Sue had so many friends already. But she doesn't have everything, Meg comforted herself. She doesn't have my long skinny legs. She can't even squeeze into my jeans. And she can't run for miles and miles as I can without getting out of breath. The girls went on in silence. The malicious amusement faded slowly from Meg's face, leaving her features pinched and sullen under the bright red hood. They reached the T-junction with Bavel Road. Meg had not wanted to go to this stupid party thing, but Mother, doing a real mother this time, had literally pushed her through the front door. Go on out! She'd said. Mix! Make friends, and don't come home until at least 8:30. Let her go, Meg had yelled back. She's the one that's so popular. She's the one with all the friends. But Mother had already closed the front door in her face. Mix my eye, Meg grumbled to herself. It's all right for her, staying at home all the time, writing, with editor's deadlines as an excuse. How many friends has she made? She should try practicing what she preaches for a change. How would she like to have to sit on her own in the schoolyard, or having to run the risk of meeting Kenny Stover at any minute? A brisk wind along Bayville Road caught the rim of Sue's hat. It was so cold. But it was only ordinary cold. Not like the cold by the ruined cottage fence. Just the thought of it made Meg shudder. Strung across Bayville Road by the school gate, a sagging banner dripped mist beads down onto the street. Meg could not read the letters clearly in the darkness, but she knew what they said. Halloween party. Mystery barrel. Bobbing for apples. Bazaar, costume parade, and hayrides. October the 31st from 7 to 10 p.m. As Meg and Sue drew closer, they could see the arc lights flooding the playing field and clusters of silhouetted figures hurrying toward it. Faint canned music throbbed on the air. Catching the excitement in spite of herself, Meg quickened her pace. Maybe out of the regular school routine, things would be better. maybe in all the fun, someone would talk to her. And maybe Kenny Stover might not be there. Or if he were, he might not make her look foolish in front of everyone. Yes, it might be all right, she told herself. It might not be so bad, after all. Chapter 2. The bazaar was in the auditorium. They went in and bought caramel apples. All of the kids in Meg's sixth grade class were there, laughing and chattering, but not one of them even looked at her. Meg gazed around the room. The whole busy scene was a bright shop window full of good things, and there she was with her nose pressed up against the cold, dark glass, not knowing how to get in. She went outside again, Sue following, to lean against a corner of the main building, licking her apple and watching them all have their fun. Sue moved away from the wall, shivering. "Come on, Meg," she said. "I'm freezing. Let's move."
"Move where?"
"Oh, I don't know. Let's bob for apples. It's warmer in a crowd."
"Ugh,"
Meg made a face. But she followed Sue, all the same, back into the light. "Hi, Sue," somebody called. Sue turned. "Oh, hi," she said. The passing imp knocked off her hat with a friendly fist.
"Cheek," Meg declared loudly. "He needs a good punch on the nose."
"Shut up, shut up," Sue whispered fiercely. She snatched up her hat and marched off. Meg followed her to the tail of the apple barrel line, mimicking her. "Hey, Sue."
"Oh, law," Meg said.
A bunch of fifth graders came up behind them.
"Come here."
A girl grabbed Sue's sleeve. "My dad's running the hay rides, and he's treating us all to a ride around the block." She tugged at Sue's arm. Sue looked at Meg.
"Oh, don't mind me."
Meg turned away.
"You'll still be here when I get back?"
Meg shrugged. "Maybe." There was a brief, awkward pause until, with a whoop, her classmates swept Sue away, exploding into loud laughter as they moved out of the front gate. Meg watched them run across Ryfield Road and onto the playing field, where the horse and hay cart waited. They were laughing at her, Meg was sure, and Sue was joining in. Well, she should care. Suddenly, it was her turn to duck. There were four barrels, or rather large rectangular troughs, standing neat as a slab of chocolate bar. She looked down, saw the fat red apples bobbing in the dark water, saw the wet faces coming up, glistening and sheepish. How grotty the water must be, with all those people slobbering into it, and how cold their faces must feel now. She stepped quickly out of line, slipped her hood back over her head and paused, irresolute, missing Sue now. She felt so self-conscious out there, all alone. At that moment, she heard a weird, thin whining, an all-too-familiar sound, like that of a mosquito with a bellyache, or Kenny Stover making noises up inside his nose. She half turned, her heart sinking. Yes, there he was, right across from her on the other side of the barrels, thinly disguised as Dracula, and sawing away on an invisible violin. Meg glanced around. Everyone was staring. She wanted to move away, but she could not. Kenny knew that she had seen him. Out of the corner of her eye, she watched him stop with a flourish and a bow. There was loud applause mixed with catcalls from a bunch of tall, broad devils, a gorilla and a skeleton. Kenny's buddies from the junior high, where he should have gone this year. Behind Kenny, to his left, clung his inevitable kid brother, Rip, a first grader, dressed as E.T. She closed her eyes. Now that little wimp was going to ask for an encore, as he always did when he was around.
"Encore! Encore!" Rip cried.
Meg could cheerfully have rammed the words down his scraggy little throat. Kenny obliged by bowing again. Now he would ape her English accent and say,
"And now for me grand finale, the flight of the bumblebee."
Then he would hoist the imaginary fiddle back up onto his shoulders and start the mosquito noise again. As she stood listening to the laughter, her face burning, she had suddenly had enough. Of Kenny, of the school, of everyone. Elbowing her way through the lines to the other side of the water troughs, she put her hand flat on Kenny's back and pushed with all her might. For one moment he stood there, an astonished look on his vampire face, then, caught off balance, he tottered and fell, fangs first, with a splash among the apples. In the silence, she walked away.
"Hey! Hey, you! Wilson!"
Kenny's voice was angry. She did not look back. She made herself walk with dignity to the corner of the school building, where, once out of sight, she hoisted her Red Riding Hood skirts and ran. Chapter 3. She locked herself in a stall in the girls' washroom, leaned against the wall, and stared blindly at Mary Likes Steve and Mrs. Jellicoe Stinks. Now she'd done it for sure. That bully, that hunk of lout, he'd kill her in plain sight of them all. She could see the headlines. Slaughter in the sixth grade. Enraged youth strangles helpless English girl. Bystanders look on. Oh, why had she done it? She could hear Father now. "You stick your neck out, Meg, and then you are surprised when you get it chopped." And look where she'd stuck it this time. Right under Kenneth Stover's nose. The whole school thought twice about crossing that bully, the dummy having to repeat sixth grade. She crossed her arms tightly as she always did when in a fix, frowning and rocking herself from side to side. Now what? Oh, where was Sue? Trust the girl not to be around when she was needed. Long minutes passed. Then there was a sudden flurry. It was time for the costume parade. Outside, in the passage, noises swelled and died. Meg listened to the sudden quiet, her hope rising. Maybe she could dodge out now while everyone was over on the playing field watching the parade. She could go through the side gate and wait for Sue along Horse Hollow Road. She opened the stall door and crept out. Her hair was a mess, and her painted cheeks had smudged up around her eyes, giving her a feverish look, but too bad about that. She opened the outer door slit. The hallway was deserted. To her right, the passage led to the front hall and entrance overlooking Ryfield Road and the playing fields. To her left, it led to a side door and a little gate onto Bayville Road. Meg turned left. She made it all the way to the side gate and was just slipping through when a shadow moved out from the gatepost.
Well, well, well.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.